But I'm here with Ken Hutchins, and we're going to be talking about the book Burn by Herman Pontzer and some of the implications for exercise, for fat loss, for general health, et cetera, into some related topics. And I know that you had a list of things that you wanted to talk about. So I'm just going to let you take the reins, and then I'll maybe comment as things occur to me.
Thank you, Drew. Due to my conditions, I've got quite a bit of brain fog, so I've got a punch list here to try to help me remember a few things. Everything I know about this is only one piece of paper. and I might update, I don't know if I've told this or not, but this past week I've been diagnosed with a second autoimmune disease. I've got now stills in as well as myositis. And the myositis marker, there's 11 of them, and they're mutual exclusive, supposedly. And the one that is showing up as elevated is also associated with cancer. Now they're trying to find out if that's real or not. But the marker is actually going down as I'm weaning off the IL-1 blocker. So it's sort of confusing. I'm not symptomatic for the myositis. So that's another thing.
So they're just going on.
It's all a mystery. And of course, Brendan and I are quite tired of it. Anyway, on top. Drew and I recommend this book. And that might be a little bit strange to you when you see how much we disagree with the book. But it is illustrative. It's illuminating to everything going on with the thought. But we need to point out what is correct here. And I'm going to go back, way back, with some of the influences. My father graduated from Baylor Medical School in 1950. And he wasn't really that interested in exercise and sports, although he was the team doctor for the local football team for quite a while. But on the issue of what he called weight loss, we got to get better with that. That's a euphemism for fat loss, which is a real thing we're after. No one wants to talk about fat. It's this ugly word. I'm not fat, I'm overweight, or my BMI is some number, which is a useless. BMI just goes back to the old height weight charts that come up with this number for it, make it convenient.
The goal is not to be a smaller fat person, it's to be leaner.
Yeah, and lean means less fat, and perhaps more muscle too. But when I was in high school, he pointed out that the jury was still out on whether weight loss was really a factor of activity or strictly due to caloric control intake. And I can remember him saying that in dealing with his obese patients, that he would poke them in their tummy with his finger and saying, oh, they would say, but doctor, I don't eat that much. And he would say, how can you be that fat if you don't eat that much? Of course, you got to define what that is relative to a person, relative to their caloric expenditure. Well, time passed, and when I was in the Air Force, I used to carry around a copy of Guyton's Medical Physiology, and I read it practically all the time. And one cascade or outline that is printed in there, which I've mentioned before in some of my writings, is that Guyton had this chart of caloric expenditures, And I'm not giving you any accurate numbers by any chance, but I'm just, for instance, you might say that the number of calories you burn per hour was asleep, might be 75. And sitting on the side of the bed, awake, might be 100. Standing might be a little more, and walking might be a little more. Walking briskly might be a little more. And then he got into activities such as running and running fast and then bicycling, and these all increased in the number of calories you were supposedly burning. And then he got into severe exercise and then very severe exercise. And then at the very, very top, the largest number of caloric expenditure was walking upstairs. And I thought, wow, this is just insane. Now, this is before we had established what exercise really was.
Maybe walking upstairs with a truck strapped to your back.
Well, moving on to me being a Nautilus, I remember one day, Arthur put Casey Viator through a workout that would have killed an adult gorilla. I mean, it was just so intense that you just couldn't imagine how difficult this was. And after the workout, Ellington Dart and I went into his office, and he said, "Now, Ken," realizing that Casey going through that workout, because of his strength, the size of his muscles, the fact that his basal metabolism is probably higher than almost anyone you could find on the planet, and that he's doing, you know, extremely intense work in a very short amount of time. So that workout lasted 30 minutes. How many calories do you think he burned above and beyond what he would normally be burning just doing his normal daily activity? And by then, I had gotten to where I was very conservative, or at least I thought, with a number that probably told us what he was burning, which had to be much more than any other person around that I knew. I said, maybe 400 calories. And L says, "Ken, I'd be surprised if he burned 200 extra calories." Now, from all that background, we come down to seeing all the readouts of caloric expenditure on the Fitbit, these online exercise consultation programs, the displays in bicycle ergometers and recumbent bikes and treadmills and stair climbers and ski machines and on and on and on. And so, as I have written and talked about, these things are extremely optimistic.
Grossly exaggerated,
I think. Grossly exaggerated. People are not burning that number. First of all, those displays and programs are not subtracting out those calories from basal metabolic rate plus what they would normally have done just walking around across the room.
Yeah, so it's not the calories that are burned as a result of the activity, minus the resting energy expenditure, but the total calories burned during the activity. And if you subtracted out the resting energy expenditure, you'd find that all that effort really didn't accomplish much except for maybe make you a little tired.
Right. So I would suppose, and there I go again, if I would do something, why don't I just go ahead and do it? You know, I suppose, you know, our language affects us and we hear things. I would advise, you know, no, I advise I'm laughing at myself here, and I'll get to that later. But I suppose that the major, if not the only reason, real reason, that most people go to the gym and get on a treadmill or do anything is to burn off weight, which really means fat. So what are they doing here? Nothing other than the fact that being on the treadmill, they probably don't have a sandwich or a donut in their hand at the same time.
Preoccupation.
Exactly. So with all of that as a precursor to Herman Ponzer's book, Burn, he finally seems to nail it. Now, I'll take his word for the efficiency and accuracy of this double label water process. I don't know much about it. I can't attest to it. But it seems like he's on to something. And I admit, he's saying what I want. He is reinforcing what I already believe, that the human body is far more efficient than what we give it credit to be.
I don't think we'd have survived this long as a species if it was any less efficient. Probably have starved to death a long time ago.
Now, he refers to himself as an
evolutionary anthropologist, was it?
Or an anthropological energy expert. Energetics, if I'm saying that right. And he has spent years using this method along with assistants and cohorts measuring the caloric expenditure of many different primates, not just apes or monkeys or humans. And in the course of this, he has found that going from being what we would call a couch potato, and some people call a sedentary person, whatever that is, to maybe running 5 miles or 10 miles a day, or doing activities such as swimming or bicycling, doesn't burn any more calories at all. Essentially, yeah. Zip. If that is the reason you're doing this, your time is worth zero.
I used to tell people that all of this additional activity was highly inefficient, that it didn't burn enough calories to be worth the time invested, at least not for the purpose of burning calories. Obviously, recreation is a whole other issue. But even that was being, you know, overly generous. It's not that it doesn't burn enough calories to be worth the time invested. It's that any additional calories expended don't make a difference at all because of how effectively our bodies are able to adjust our metabolism to constrain our daily energy expenditure. So you are, if you are doing this for the sake of fat loss, you are, it's not just inefficient, it is a complete waste of time for that purpose.
Yeah, we used to say our time was not worth much. Now we know it's not worth anything at all.
But not for fat loss. Yeah, you know, some people like to do it.
Yeah,
but for fat loss.
Yeah, we're just talking about fat loss, which he calls weight loss, which is a huge problem. If you read books, which I really like, by Jason Fung and others, they refer to weight loss all the time. They really don't call it what it is, and that is a major hang up with the doctors, with the medical professionals.
People, again, you mentioned this earlier, people don't like the word fat. They don't like it. And again, we hear people saying that people are overweight. They're not overweight. They're overfat.
Right.
If we call it what it is, they're overfat. They're not overweight. They don't need to lose weight. They need to lose fat specifically. We all know people who have, you know, maybe they're, you know, above average musculature, maybe they're, you know, just taller, who are heavier by far than the average person, but not nearly as fat. Do they have a problem because of how heavy they are? No, it has nothing to do with the weight on the scale. It's how much of it is fat versus lean body mass. And we really, I think, need to hammer that home with everybody. And I do this myself sometimes. Like, I catch myself when I'm going to say overweight and try to always correct to over fat, because that really is.
Well, my rheumatologist is, you know, my weight, primarily because of my fat, entirely due to me overeating, is increasing. My BMI is going up. And of course, I get this handout printed out from the hospital about how to increase my activity and control my quote unquote weight. I mean, it's totally misconstrued, totally misapplied. There are people very similar to how marginalized my health, balance, mobility is. You make them more active, they're going to fall and get seriously injured, if not dead. So, anyway, on down the line, I credit Herman here with really nailing down not only that intake is the situation, and the old idea that it's calories in, calories out. Well, it's not. It's only about calories in.
Oh yeah, with fat loss.
Yeah, because you can't, you can control one. You can't control the calories out.
It's both, but the calories out is so well constrained by our bodies that it is pointless to focus on trying to increase that through activity, right, as opposed to decreasing.
Yeah, the calories out is important, but we can't do much about it.
Other than increasing our muscle mass.
Right, and we'll get to this in a minute, which he completely ignores, but I want to focus on what he gets right here. Down the road into the book, he strongly and clearly condemns all of the food combination theories and the idea that special foods will burn fat selectively. And he clearly just says it's BS, and it is. It's hucksterism. That's all it is. Now, let's see if I can see some other things here. There are exceptions to what he's saying, but these exceptions you don't want to hear about. There are some very unusual people who are engaged in some very unusual activities, such as running across the United States and performing the essence of 6 marathons every 7 days, and some people doing 7 out of 7. They will get to a point after a little while, if they don't destroy their bodies, of actually burning more calories due to the extra activity.
There is a limit to how much our bodies can adapt the metabolic rate to compensate for an increase in activity, but that limit is beyond what is practical for almost anybody.
Oh.
And that amount of activity would literally destroy your joints and spine.
And your immune system.
Oh, yeah, immune system. Yeah. The oxidative stress from that would cause so
many severe muscle loss.
Yeah, which would be counterproductive, because then you have a lower metabolic rate.
So you need to know about that exception, but it's an extreme. I mean, these are like Drew says here, totally impractical for anyone. Now, you might wonder why I would recommend this book when there is so much incorrect in it too. It is, as I said earlier, very illuminating because you're looking at a broad swath. This is a seminal book.
Everything about how our bodies constrain our energy expenditure, basically to prevent us from starving, to prevent us from using up our fat stores faster just because of the additional activity. It is, we've evolved to be very, very energy efficient.
Well, one thing I want to stick in here is that, I see those who recommend that we talk only about the positive or something. Don't say anything negative about something. Just stress the positive. That is extremely weak, and weak for several reasons, which I'm not going to waste everyone's time going into. But you've got to cover. You know, if I say recommend this book, and you say, "Wow, Ken Hutchins is correct about this," but why would he have me read all this stuff that is absolutely embarrassing?
And it's frustrating because there are a lot of books that have little bits of information that are great, but then they go and they give all sorts of bad advice, or sometimes they give advice that is correct, but for the wrong reasons. Mm-hmm. And it's important that people understand, if you're going to recommend a book, the reasons that you do recommend it, but also to be aware that the recommendation does not mean that you say that everything in that book is correct, because
like Arthur hammered me on, Ken, you're not going to learn anything from people you already agree with. Well, it just so happens, I don't care for anthropologists, especially cultural anthropologists. You know, I was groomed on the writings of Robert Ardrey. Now, you say the word Robert Ardrey to almost any anthropologist, and you have flipped their switch because they hate the guy, from what I can tell. You know, and most of them haven't even read Robert Ardrey. But one thing in there, in his last book, was the New Age word, hunter-gatherer, which serves no good purpose at all. And I'm going to guess that Herman here uses that word 100 times in this book.
Was this from The Hunting Hypothesis?
Yeah, that was his last book, yes. And Ardrey points out that it serves no good purpose because what actually happened was that we focused on meat. We came from primates, primarily the apes, who were for the most part vegetarians. Now, chimps are now known and have been known for quite a while now to go on organized hunts to kill and eat monkeys. And so does that make them a hunter-gatherer? And on the other end of the spectrum, you've got the largest carnivores, the brown bears, the grizzlies, and the black bears. They all spend most of their time, or most of the years, digging for roots and berries, and here in Florida, whatever they can dig out of our garbage cans. Does that make them a hunter-gatherer too? So where's this distinction other than the fact, just like with weight loss, we're dealing with another euphemism, because and it's sissified. It's a sissified euphemism to ignore the fact that we're basically killers.
Yep.
If you go to the slaughterhouse and see how many chickens we massacre every day so we can enjoy them at Arby's or at Chick-fil-A, or how many cattle we massacre every day. Well, you know, we don't want to talk about that. We're hunter-gatherers, which now, one thing that Herman does here, which is excellent, but he doesn't go far enough. Now we're basically talking about caloric economics, which is energetics, which is his field here, his specialty, I should say. Well, he talks about how the other apes don't share. And that in terms of the devotion, you've got a finite amount of energy that you've got that nature directs for survival. And in his presentation, he points out that ours has been directed toward a larger brain. And to have in brain tissue is very expensive.
To build and to
make it, and if you're going to devote that put that energy there, you have to take it from somewhere else. And if you're going to have a larger brain, you're going to have a bigger skull. If you've got a bigger skull, you've got to have a longer gestation and development for that child, which involves pressure to share the food source. Everybody pitches in. And this is still about energy. And it's being constrained across the group or the society or whatever you want to call this. Now, he seems to claim that this is a major turning point in the development of the human species. And I believe he's correct. But in so doing, he completely overlooks another one, and that is the development of the family. Now, Ardrey talks about that in his last book, which I don't know if other anthropologists talk about this or not. I didn't mean to call Ardrey an anthropologist. He's not. He's a writer and dramatist and all that. He's an anthropology critic, you might say. But Ardrey makes a great case of how the human female, not the egotistical male, he had nothing to do with this. He contributed nothing to this. It was the female that invented the family. When we became standing erect, she invented, more or less, frontal copulation.
Oh.
Yeah. This is a big deal. Year-round sex instead of the seasonal estrus.
Which is, are we one of the only mammals for which that is an option? I can't think of others. There might be others, but I think it's just us.
I don't believe there is, but I'm not going to stand on that because I don't know for sure. But if we mainly confine this to primates, my father always taught me, never get in the face of a wild animal. That's very confrontational. You're going to get your face bitten off.
Good advice.
Okay. Now, something had to emerge for the benefit of the creation of the family for this confrontational face-to-face principle to be dissolved. We had to somehow play that down. Now, we still have within our language getting in somebody's face. Okay? Well, that has to be reduced. There has to be a bonding. And with the frontal copulation, year-round sex, breast enlargement, breast exaggeration. Now, I have not written much about this, but I talk quite a bit about how important the breasts are for sex. They are not, as most people believe, traditionalists will be offended by this, and I say, get over it. But the breasts are not for feeding the children.
It's mostly fatty tissue.
It's fatty tissue. The breast or just like a rooster's comb, or the exaggeratedly red butts of a baboon, excuse me. They are sexual attractants, or the birds of prey, which in some of those cases are territorial things, not necessarily sexual attractants, as I've been taught. But both Robert Ardrey and Desmond Morris, the author of Naked Ache, says that if you cannot justify the breast exaggeration in the human female as a sexual ornamentation, if you can't justify for that, it is maladaptive.
I remember a long time ago, I tried to convince a bunch of local plastic surgeons, cosmetic surgeons, to refer women to us for exercise instruction in preparation for breast augmentation because of how much every little bit of volume increase increases the torque on the spine. Uh-huh. And spent some time figuring this out. I can't remember because this was way back, but with every increase in cup size, the load on the lower back is tremendous. Obviously, this is why women have breast reduction surgery. I got no response. They don't want to tell somebody, you're going to have to do this. You're going to have to exercise and strengthen your back to be able to handle the increased load. But I remember being surprised at how much of a difference that makes. And obviously, very large-breasted women could probably just tell us, that especially if they try to jog or are involved in sports where there's a lot of, you know, bouncing and moving around.
Right.
It is a significant energy expenditure to add all that fatty tissue. It is a lot of weight being carried in a position that is putting a lot more stress on the lower back. There would have to be a significant benefit to incur the costs and the negatives that come with that.
Well, Ardrey refers to all of this, and it involves some other factors, as the sexual revolution. Not the one that we hear about in the 1960s. No, this way back. It was a much bigger deal biologically. It's not that the human female deliberately contrived this. It happened to her, but it was, you know, without these things I'm talking about, and it also involved the lack of frontal hair, especially around the face. It involved the GO signal, which is the dilation of the pupil, which is, you know, was discovered 20 or 30 years ago. All of these things add up. Now, it's normal, common that I encounter a woman every now and then who, if we get into a discussion of this, they get very defensive about it. They have this wholesome attitude about their breasts. Couldn't possibly be for sex. These are to feed my children. And you know, my breasts swell when I start lactating with them. Of course they do, because you've got the mammary gland running through there. But remember that the word mammal comes from the fact that we are specialized with mammary glands. That is what feeds the young. And mammary glands exist without breast throughout the primates.
Yep.
And pound for pound, volume for pound, they give just as much milk for their young, even though they don't have breast. Now, where did mammary glands come from? Well, my histology professor at Texas Tech, you know, preached that they were actually specialized sweat glands. Not that matters to this argument at all. But what does matter, if you go back 110 million years, now I don't remember exactly when the mammalian line started, but the platypus was around 110 million years. Now, was the platypus a mammal? I don't know. It's very difficult to
there's something out there.
They are weird. They have a duck bill. They have web feet. They have fur.
those weird spines, poison spines.
Yeah, they have a poison spine on I think on the males, I'm not sure. But they lay eggs. Now, and here's the big one, the one I'm getting to, is that they have mammary glands. They feed their young with milk.
They don't have nipples, though.
They have no nipples. Not only do they not have breasts, they have no nipples. The milk is excreted on their bellies, and the young lick it off of them. Like I said, they're strange. Now, think about this. 110 million years ago, this is so far back that the continent of Australia, along with Tasmania, were actually butted up against South America. The continents were contiguous. So, I believe that this would be an important part of Herman's argument that's involved, I think, with the sharing, which was basically what he was talking about. And he missed all that. He could have done that.
With the development of the family, a female would be more successful at getting at least one male, if they attracted the relatively successful one, of providing resources for and protection for them and their offspring.
Right. That had to occur without the family and then the greater group, society, whatever. There was not going to be any success or survival.
Well, because of how much longer it takes for us to reach maturity, it would probably be necessary, because in a lot of other species, the male contributes genetic material, but then that's about it.
Right. Well, this bonding had to occur for anything to survive, for the sharing to take place, which Herman talks about. Now, let me review my notes a little bit here. I've gotten pretty far down the road with what I wanted to talk about for the most part. I do want to touch a little bit more on the fact that to talk about the breast as being purely a sexual ornamentation, some women, even men, get highly offended with this, and they think it's demeaning to women. How does inventing the family, how is that demeaning? The female is the one that held it all together. And like I said earlier, the male contributed nothing to this.
Some genetic material.
Well, he was already doing that.
That's true.
And nothing extra. Okay, so I've already slammed him on the politically correct sissified euphemism of hunter-gatherer. Now, another thing he gets into, and I think he's getting a little political here, that doesn't belong
later in the book.
Doesn't belong in this discussion, and it's not the reason I'm bringing it up. I'm bringing it up because of the scientific miscarriage or disconnect he has with energy. Somewhere in there, a couple of times, he mentions CO2 emissions as though they're bad. Now, I've been asking around with the restaurants I frequent, and sometimes when I'm with you, some of the staff over here at one place, mostly high school students. And what I'm trying to find out is, and I really don't remember in my case, when did I learn photosynthesis?
That's high school biology.
Yeah, well, everyone I've talked to so far thinking they learned it in junior high, and then they reviewed it again in high school. And so without getting into a balanced chemical equation, you basically have CO2 plus water yields sugar and oxygen. So what is wrong with CO2? How is it, quote, in a pejoratively slanted emission, a pollutant? It is not. It is. Where is Herman on this? Why can't he connect the two? Why does he slam it?
As he's been told,
yeah,
that's a bad thing.
Anyway, he really exposed himself there. Now, in another place, he talks about, well, he gets the volume and intensity thing all mixed up. In a couple of places, he uses the word intensity almost correctly, but he sort of recommends that if I'm paraphrasing, and this is not exact, it's not an exact quote attributed to him, but he more or less says, if you're in doubt about exercise, more would be better.
Part of the problem, too, is he fails to distinguish between exercise and non-exercise physical activity, and regularly uses the term exercise when it's obvious that he means locomotor activities and steady state activities.
Right. He is clueless on the definition of exercise. And he is hanging out with the exercise physiologists, and none of them understand it either. Basically, because they don't know about inroad. Of course, there's no mention of inroad anywhere in the book, nor would I expect it to be, because, as I said in an earlier interview, a rhetorical question I made in an earlier interview is, have you ever heard anyone in medicine coaching community or athletics or exercise physiology, you mentioned inroad? No, because it's not on their radar at all, and it is the key to exercise. But what I'm trying to hammer here in this particular notation is that along with this mention of sheer volume, which is a bad idea, he talks about the other benefits of what he's calling so-called exercise, being, a way to relieve depression. Granted, that's true and important. But also, the reduction of testosterone.
That's a huge negative.
Oh, that is a horrible thing to say. Now, I think, I don't know, but I believe I know where this comes from. Okay. Now, in the early 1940s, I think 41 to be specific, there was a University of Chicago educated doctor by the name of Charles Huggins.
They had like three or four case studies, if I'm thinking of the same.
Right. Okay. He did research, probably on rats, I believe, but also he did some human studies. He had very few subjects, and he used a test called acid phosphatase, which was later found to be extremely unreliable. And he produced a dictum that went cross-platform in all of the medical schools, that thou shalt not ever provide supplemental testosterone to someone who has prostate cancer. In fact, the idea that it was like pouring gasoline on a fire.
That turned out not to be true.
Not true at all. Well, my father grew up believing that, although he and I never discussed it. And I can almost guarantee you that, oh, by the way, Huggins received a Nobel Prize for this in 1966. This is how influential this became throughout the medical community. Now, in the early 2000s, a young Harvard-trained urologist by the name of Abraham Morgentaler started sniffing around here. And his mentors and colleagues said, don't go there, you'll ruin your career. Well, he found this library, went down into this basement of archives. I mean, this place had copies of The Lancet back into the 1800s.
Wow.
And he actually found Huggins' original work. And this is how we know that in 41, he messed it all up, got it all wrong. And so Morgenthaler started redoing the work, looking at it, studying it. And he concluded that not only was there not enough work to substantiate Huggins' claim, but that if anything, being too low in testosterone would be a problem leading to prostate cancer. Now, we're talking about what I believe only heard one doctor use this term, and this was a pathologist, that we're talking about what's known as endogenous levels of testosterone, not going out of the normal bounds with exogenous levels, but with endogenous levels some people really do need to be supplemented. And now, some of this goes back, in my way of thinking, I've never read anything on it, but I was taught that the uterus and the prostate, the uterus in the female, the prostate in the male, are analogous structures. And we do know that as women go through menopause, before menopause, if everything is working right, you've got a balance, an opposition between estrogen and progesterone. Now, after menopause, the estrogen falls to here. Progesterone bottoms out. And so you've got what's known, as Dr. John Lee propounded this word, estrogen dominance and all kinds of problems. Estrogen can be, and there's three different kinds. Estrogen dominance can be a real problem, especially for women. But why might not it be a real problem for men? And since the prostate is the analogous structure to the uterus, why, and I really don't know what I'm talking about, I'm suggesting in this only, supposing only, that it's the estrogen that's the problem. Now, I've known prostate patients that I've worked with who were on chemical castration drugs, like Lupron, because testosterone, going back to Huggins, is considered to be the bad thing.
Wow.
Now, Brenda was being interviewed by a doctor who is now a close friend of ours out in Texas around 2015. And we were out meeting, he's an MD by the name of Paul Mays, really friendly guy. And a good doctor, he's third generation MD. And, you know, when you first sit down with someone, you don't know exactly what you can talk about, what's going to offend them, where their stance is on whatever subject. So I was really curious. I had just moved into the area, and I needed my testosterone supplementation done. And I went to a doctor who was a doctor for my family for many years, took care of my mother, And he says, oh, yeah, I'll sign off on your testosterone, but I want a PSA test first. And so I'm thinking, why do you need a PSA test on me? So zoom forward a couple of weeks, and we're having dinner for the first time. I'm just meeting Paul, and we're having a nice conversation with the four of us, he and his wife and Brenda and I. And I just couldn't stop myself. I had to ask him about what I had just experienced about my testosterone supplementation approval. And I said, are you by any chance familiar with a urologist by the name of Abraham Morgenthaler? And he, you know, perked up and he says, yeah, I have his book. It's really good. And why do you ask? And I said, I told him my story. And as I'm telling him that my doctor had requested a PSA test, Paul is, I said, what does that mean? He says he doesn't know. He says most doctors don't know.
Yeah, which is,
of course, my other doctor friends said he may have just been, you know, doing a CYA. Yeah. But anyway.
Well, this brings up a point, actually. This is a good argument against too much volume of exercise or activity.
Yes, yes, another one. Opposed, you know, in addition to
so,
the.
So he's giving the opposite recommendation of what he should be based on the erroneous assumption that lower testosterone is better. When, and just, this is anecdotal, but I have trained a lot of men who have been, you know, given testosterone, hormone replacement or testosterone replacement therapy, and mostly older men, but I've also had a client who unfortunately lost a testicle in a motorcycle accident. And in every single case, everybody has reported significant improvements in overall health, quality of life, and they definitely, you know, performed better. They made better progress in their workouts with the hormone supplementation than without it. I can't imagine any doctor that actually has any experience with this recommending against it. It only makes sense if they are uninformed.
Yes. Yes. Right. Now, when this information first got to me, it was in a trying to think of the magazine. Anyway, Brenda read about it in a magazine. It'll come to me here in a minute. She'd been trying to get me to read this article since December of 2008. And if I can't think of it,
I'll post it.
We can post it. Everyone can get it. Well, anyway, you know, I don't want to read this. You know, leave me alone. Well, finally, a couple of months later, we were well into 2009. I said, wow, I better read this. And I thought, wow, this was, you know, the article written as an excerpt of a chapter out of Morgenthaler's book. And so I couldn't believe what I was reading. And so I got it to Philip Alexander, my other Texas internal medicine friend. And I said, what do you think? And he writes back, undoubtedly, this is going to be hotly debated for years. And so, I know what I'll do. I'll send it over to Cheryl Stansberry, my local internal medicine friend. And I thought, well, this will probably get her riled up and she's going to shut me down for this. To my surprise, she called me right back. And she says, where can I get that article? And so I tell her the name of the publication. And she says, oh, I take that. But I never read it. I put it out for my patients in the reception room, and they're welcome to read it. And if any of them want to, you know, take the magazine, they're welcome to it. But she says, right now, I got a patient that's desperate for this information. And so I found a way to get it to her more directly. And anyway, that's how I became acquainted with it.
And later, I will look up Morgenthaler's book, and I'll provide a link so that people that are interested can read that as well.
Okay. Well, let's go into some other things. I beat that one to death, but I want everybody to know that. It's important.
It is important because, again, tying it back into the volume of exercise, you need to exercise. And it is also not just important, it's absolutely essential to make a distinction between exercise and recreation and other activities, because we need exercise. It's not just something that is beneficial, it's something that is absolutely necessary. But if people don't understand the distinction between the two, they might be doing other activities believing that they're getting exercise when they're not.
It's life extension. 2008, December 2008, life extension.
Okay. I'll see if I can find a link to that and post it as well.
Yeah, it should be pretty easy to find. Okay, moving on here. Herman also conflates aerobics, the proper noun, with aerobic, the adjective describing the metabolic pathway in biochemistry. And, you know, all of these exercise physiology types are doing this, and Herman needs to be very aware of that grammatical miscarriage. It's very important.
We probably shouldn't even call them exercise physiologists, maybe activity physiologists, because none of them are actually studying exercise,
right?
Or
now,
almost none.
Now, he, at the end of the book, talks about his future work, investigating the caloric expenditures of all these different activities, but he calls it exercise. He's not doing any work in exercise. He's not lying about it. He just doesn't know that it's misnamed. And it's not. They're not exercise.
This deserves an entire different conversation, but that's something that I think we really need to spend some time talking about and telling people about, is why it is so important to strictly define exercise and to make that distinction between exercise and recreation.
Yeah, now,
it's not just semantics.
Now, I'm not going to sit here and read out the definition of exercise again, but it seems like I have to do that every single time. I'm not going to do that in this interview, but
I'll post it down in the comments.
It's on the website. Another thing is that he completely misses the importance of stroke volume. Talks about aerobics and getting the heart rate up, and that is not the point. You will get your heart rate up if you get your stroke volume up, but the heart rate getting up is not the point.
It's cardiac output overall, not just heart. I think the reason for the fixation on heart rate, is just like the fixation on VO2, is because it's something that they can measure.
Mm-hmm.
Cardiac output, no. Overall, not practical, not without surgically implanting, what is it? They'd have to put a catheter in you. That would be, it's not something that you're going to want to subject yourself to on a regular basis.
Well, one thing he might address in his future writings and study is not getting the heart rate up, but lymphatics, because it's a passive circulation that would be enhanced by just moving around.
Thus, the reason that exercise and activity are important. We have to make the distinction between the two, but something that I've told people is that they need both. They need to exercise very intensely, but briefly and infrequently, but they should be relatively active. And because of these other things, they need exercise to to stimulate the desired improvements in the general trainable factors of functional ability, but they need to be physically active for those circulatory benefits, not just because the muscular pump aids with circulation of blood, but also lymph and some benefits to the joints of maybe not the activity, but not being sedentary.
Now, I've already mentioned, and we've talked a little bit about weight loss versus fat loss, BMI being worthless, all that kind of thing. Well, it's not totally worthless. If you don't change the size of your muscles and your weight goes up, well, the only thing you can be fat.
Pretty much.
Right.
You're not increasing your bone mass by that much.
No. Well, you could increase the size of some organs, I guess, but as he points out, that I believe he does mention that. But in the same regard of weight loss versus fat loss, he gets into some of the work done with the contestants in The Biggest Loser.
Was a disaster.
Yeah. Well, he talks about how they lost their basal metabolic rates went down. He doesn't say why.
They were probably losing
muscle
and probably some other organ mass because of the fact they were barely eating anything. They're starving.
Well, you know, I have made a point throughout my writings that the greatest consumer of calories after perhaps the digestive system is skeletal muscle, volitional skeletal muscle.
If you lose muscle,
and but Herman says it's the brain. Is the brain really more expensive, or is it just because he hasn't looked at the entire muscular system collectively?
From what if I'm remembering this correctly, nervous tissue is a little more expensive, but we have far more muscle mass than nervous tissue, and we can't practically increase our nervous tissue. So it's a moot point. We can make a big difference in the amount of skeletal muscle that we have.
Well, I've argued that there's more mitochondria in the muscle, in the skeletal muscle.
Which?
I've never compared that, I will admit, to the number of mitochondria in the brain.
If I recall, the brain's primary and nervous system primary fuel source is carbohydrates. So seems like it would be more anabolic.
But again, the brain is not performing any mechanical work. Yeah.
So it's, well, in either case, it's a huge mistake to ignore muscle mass in the role. He does talk about, again, weight being, if you look at sex and age and weight, it pretty much across cultures, different people, that is a better predictor of daily energy expenditure than activity by far. And that's actually one of the interesting things from earlier on the book when they were comparing the Hadza to Western populations, despite being far more active, doing more in a single day than most Westerners do in an entire week. If you compare sex, weight, and age, the daily calorie expenditure was still the same. But muscle, and this is something else I wanted to mention, is muscle versus lean body mass. And it reminded me of it, since you talked about the organ mass, is I know a lot of times when people are losing, they're trying to lose fat, but sometimes they see that there's a reduction in lean body mass and they get worried, oh no, I'm losing muscle. But I recall L. Darden would talk about, I think it was a 1975 study by, I think it was Goldspink, on the rats, and they were starving them.
Yes.
They had no growth hormone, no testosterone, and they still had hypertrophy of the soleus in the leg where they still had the gastrocnemius. and that a muscle will grow at the expense of all the other tissues in your body, despite starvation and all these other things, if you have a stimulus. So when people see that their weight is down, but also they've lost a little bit of lean body mass with their fat mass, I suspect that part of, if not all of that lean body mass is just coming from a decrease probably in digestive organ size because they're eating less, they're not using the digestive organs as much, assuming that they are exercising, in which case they would be keeping all their muscle mass. And so when people like come back to me and they say, well, my DEXA scan showed me that I lost all this fat, but I also lost 2 pounds of muscle. I said, you don't lose 2 pounds of muscle. You lost 2 pounds of lean body mass, but that's everything other than fat. Are you getting stronger? Well, yeah, then you didn't lose any muscle. This is probably digestive organs that are reducing because you're eating less, you're not placing as much of a demand on. Missing out on the role of muscle in this is one of the things that I'm disappointed in the book.
Well, I don't want Herman to think that we're condemning him or the book.
Oh, no. Overall, it's a net positive.
Yes, it's a net positive. And I believe that with this discussion, it'll give him and others, but I'm mainly directing this to him. He's opened this door, and it's an important door to open to go through to investigate these other things that we've brought up. It's an opportunity here, I hope, for his research to go in directions that are productive.
I would hope so. I'll have to send him a link and invite him to watch and provide, you know, some feedback. Maybe, I don't know if this is practical, but possibly have a three-way conversation at some point if he's available.
Sure.
It'd be interesting. Anything else that you'd want to add with regards to, you know, activity versus diet, any of these, anything related to this fat loss or any just general guidelines for people?
Oh, there is one point that I forgot. And I partly agree with Herman on this, but disagree as well. He mentioned that calorie counting is pretty much useless. I disagree. I agree that it's tedious. But I believe that it's important to have some reference, some guideline on what you eat someday. And I know calorie counting is, first of all, you know, the accuracy of whatever the reference is always in doubt. But you've got to have some guideline to, okay, today I'm going to try to stay under 1,000 calories or under 1,500, or, you know, just based on the things I know in the diet that I usually eat. And it takes a while to get to where you're current with these numbers, so that, you know, I don't go over.
If nobody, no matter how disciplined they are, they're probably not going to do it lifelong. But even if they were just to do it for a short period of time, by measuring, by weighing the food, and by paying attention to how much they're consuming, they will get an idea of what are appropriate serving sizes of different foods for them. And my recommendation one of L. Darden's recommendations that I like to pass on to people is that you don't have to constantly weigh and measure or record everything. Most people will be able to eat the same things for breakfast and lunch most of the time, as long as they have a little variety in their dinner. So you pick two or three different breakfasts that you like. You pick two or three different lunches that you like, and as long as you eat those consistently and you know the calories, you don't have to record it every time as long as you are measuring somewhat accurately. And then you pick a larger variety of dinners that you like, that maybe have a different thing each night of the week. And when you eat those on a regular basis, you learn how much of these things that you can eat. And then you only have to do the weighing and measuring when you occasionally have something different. But if you're relatively consistent with the few things that you like, assuming that it's pretty well balanced and that the energy is appropriate for you, you don't have to constantly do it. You have to do it long enough to learn how much you can eat of different things, and then you just have to be relatively consistent with that.
Well, a couple more things related to that is that my dad told me a story one time about this woman he was trying to help with her quote-unquote weight, and that he'd given her a diet to follow, and part of it was to have a grapefruit every morning for breakfast. And she came back in a few, a week or two later, and nothing had changed on the scale. And he says, well, let's break this down. What are you eating? He says, well, I had to make a substitution here or there. And he says, what? Well, I didn't have any grapefruit, so I substituted a piece of lemon meringue pie because it was smaller. Well, now I'm going to jump tracks a little bit. There are those people, and my dad dealt with them too, who claim to have a glandular problem. Yeah, now.
I've run into a bunch of, I just had somebody bring this up
for you. Now, today we call it a hormonal problem. Yeah. But back in those days, they called it a glandular problem. And yes, there are people with very suppressed basal metabolisms.
Some, few.
Yeah, there are very few. But my dad, he did a great job of combating that excuse. He says, look around the world at all those millions of people who were in concentration camps in the Philippines and the Nazis with the gulags, and, millions and millions of people who starve to death, and some that starve for quite a while. He says, when we rescued those people, there was not a single fat person, not a single one. So don't give me this glandular problem I have as an excuse.
And that really is what it is. It's an excuse. Even if somebody has a lower metabolic rate, there is a lower limit to what it is, because you need a certain amount of energy just for all of your tissues to be alive. If you don't have enough getting to your tissues, then you're an organ failure. It can only go so low.
Yeah, well, I really feel for these people because they are really imprisoned in their own body. And in my own way, I struggle. I think, gracious, what can I enjoy? What can I eat today that isn't just nothing,
Yeah, I'm in the process right now, too. I was about 220. I let myself get a little too heavy. I was about 227. Right now, I'm about 218, so I'm down about 9. And I want to eat all sorts of things, but I just have to say, but this is what I'm going to eat today, and that's it. And if I had a very low metabolic rate and I had to restrict that even further, it would be hard. Not impossible, though. It would just be hard. Unfortunately, it's not impossible for these people. They just have to eat even less. So they have to be even more careful about the foods that they do eat, that they provide the maximum satiety relative to the calories. So it sucks, and it is terribly.
Did you ever know my client by the name of John Robertson?
I think I remember. Did I think I might have trained him and his wife a few times.
He had a client. He said that who reported to him that years before he had been grossly obese, and had high blood pressure, type 2 diabetic that was out of control. And he went to work overseas with some international conglomerate, and they were in a country that became quite unstable politically, and there was a military coup, and they all got marched off to a concentration camp for a couple of years.
Wow.
And that he was one of the only people that survived. And his medical problems had all gone away, and everybody else died.
So maybe instead of opening exercise studios, we should establish a prison camp and just put people in there for a few
years.
Well,
we actually had the idea for a while of getting a loan and buying Alcatraz Island and turning it into a fat farm.
It would work.
Yeah.
I can remember.
It could be successfully structured.
I remember this coming up in conversation. I think I remember you actually saying this to some people on occasion, that there you could not guarantee that they would lose fat on the program because you had no control over what they would do as soon as they walked out the door. Although there is something that they could do, but they wouldn't like it. And that would be if they agreed to be put in a cage for several months and give you complete control over their access to food.
You're right. That's I remember that. Man, that was my guaranteed program.
Yeah, that's the only way that it works.
Said, give me $10,000 up front, and I'll build a cage for you, put you in it, slide the food under the door. And if we don't achieve results, it is my fault.
As long as we make sure nobody else is sneaking on food.
Right.
But yeah, that's really about it. Again, I do feel sorry for people that are in that situation, but fat loss is not impossible for them. It's just a lot more difficult. But, and this is a whole nother topic, it seems to me that there are so many predatory companies, and I say predatory, I really think this is just terrible, that try to appeal to these people who are desperate by telling them it's not their fault. You know, you have no control over this. It's your metabolism, it's your hormones, it's all this other stuff, and you need to do, you know, this program or take that. And the problem is that it's simply not true. It is not their fault that they have a particular condition, but the fact that they are overfat is because of consistently overeating relative to their energy demands. It sucks, but they still have to take responsibility. And this is a good thing, because if it's their fault, it also means that they have control over it, and that if they are willing to be disciplined and do the work, that they can change it. But I'm getting off a little bit of a tangent. They need to strength train if they're going to do this. Because if anything is going to help the situation, it's going to be more muscle, increasing their metabolic rate. If they want to be able to eat more, they need to strength train. They need to exercise.
Well, you know, Herman pretty much accuses the people in the fitness industry of taking advantage of these people and selling them on the notion that they can burn off their fat. And he's right. It's
a waste of time.
As far as I'm concerned, in my opinion, it's fraud. Now I make a distinction here. To me, the word bogus just means it's wrong. The word fraud, at least in my understanding, means that you deliberately deceived somebody for your gain. And if they unknowingly do it, if they believe in what they're doing, that's just bogus. But if they know they're doing this, it's
I think most of the fraud in the industry is probably in the supplement companies. I've talked with people from, you know, NSCA and NASM and ACE and AFAA and IDEA and a bunch of these groups. And a lot of these instructors have no idea what they're talking about. They are so badly misinformed.
Yeah, they're not committing fraud. They just don't know.
Yeah, I try to point that out.
They sincerely believe in what they're doing most of the time.
Yeah. They are not hucksters. They have just been terribly misinformed. They mean well. They want to help people. They think they're helping people, but they have no idea what they're talking about most of the time. But with a lot of the weight loss stuff being promoted, the claims are exaggerated. I've seen people, well, maybe they are this ignorant, but I have seen some of these group activity, they're not exercise, it's activity, group activity classes like Zumba, kickboxing, and some of these so-called boot camps advertised as burning, you know, 800 to 1,000 calories per hour, which is just absolutely absurd. First, And I think part of it comes from they are making assumptions about energy expenditure based on shorter activities and assuming that if somebody is able to maintain a certain level of effort for that time, that they're going to burn that much. Nobody is working that hard for that long. And even if they are, they're still not burning that many calories in addition to resting energy expenditure. I'm getting off on it.
But you are keeping them out of the refrigerator.
Yes, which is and you wrote about this decades ago,
but when they get injured, they're going to get laid up on the couch watching TV, bored to tears, and eat more.
Now, so, and this is explains two different things. One, people take up a hobby or they start a project that is very time consuming, and they notice that they're losing fat, and they assume it's because of the additional activity. When the real reason is the preoccupation causes them to eat less. They're so busy doing whatever it is that they've started that they're not sitting in front of a TV or now their computers putting food in their face. On the other hand, person gets injured, something happens and they have to be inactive for some period of time, and they're not going to burn fewer calories because their body adjusts to constrain their daily energy expenditure, but they're eating more because they're not preoccupied with these other activities. But again, now they've put on fat and they've assumed it's because of the reduction in physical activity when it's really because they're just eating more. And I think, again, this is probably the biggest benefit. This is the biggest reason I would recommend that people read Burn is to understand how well our bodies constrain that. One of the examples he gave in the book was a study of a group of people that were training to run a half marathon. Which, what is it, 24.6 miles or 26.4? I don't remember how many miles there is in a marathon, but half marathon is about 13 miles, somewhere in there. And apparently they worked up to the point where they were running 50, 60 miles a week, if I remember correctly. Anyway, they were sedentary people that started training to run a half marathon. Significant increase in physical activity. And there was initially a little bit of an increase in energy expenditure, but within about 2 weeks, their bodies had adapted to it. And after that, it didn't make any difference. And despite that increase in activity, there was no significant difference in body fat. And something that Mike Moran had pointed out to me, this is what like 1994, 1995, how many aerobics instructors are fat? And these women, and jazzercise and Zumba and all of this. And these women are often teaching two or three classes a day, most days of the week. If this stuff actually burned as many calories, if it had the effect on energy expenditure that they claim it does or believe it does, then there would not be any fat jazzercise or any fat Zumba or fat aerobics instructors. But there's fat postal workers.
And going back to what Herman alludes to, there wouldn't be a human species either.
Yeah, we would have starved to death a long time.
Yeah, I mean, the body has to be extremely efficient.
There's anything else that we haven't touched on the list?
I think we killed it all.
I think so. Exercise, the definition of exercise, and maybe exercise versus recreation for the next one.
Okay.
Sounds like a plan. Well, anyways, thank you for taking the time coming in and talking about this.
Enjoyed it.
I hope
this is helpful.
Yeah, I'll include a link to Herman's book here. And then if anybody has questions, go ahead and post them in the comments. And I'll pass the questions along to you, and I'll answer some of the questions to the best of my ability.
Sure.
And I hope everybody enjoyed and got some benefit from the video.
Take care.